Good morning, everyone. hope you are doing good. So we are in the fifth week now. So that is the halfway of the course. We have total 10 sessions, as you know. So this is the fifth clinical contact session. And this week's topic was is HIV-associated malignancies and dermatology. So like every time, I expect everyone to go through these two sessions, which are already there on the Canvas. Some people mentioned few challenges in accessing Canvas. If the challenge still persists, I request you to contact Mr. Praveen, and he can help you in answering those or responding those questions. So this week we will talk about two again huge topics. I don't know how much we'll be able to discuss. So as a facilitator, I'll try to like every time the way we do it. These two sessions which are uploaded on the Canvas, first we will go through those sessions, or you might have already gone through them, and I'll try to present the NACO's perspective on that. But both the topics are so wide and so huge that we'll not be able to discuss everything about it, but whatever we can in this 1.5 hours, let's try to talk about those things. Another request from the group, if there is any dermatologist or oncologist, please feel free to express your views or feel free to answer the queries asked by the other participants. I myself am neither dermatologist nor oncologist, so I'll just try to facilitate the session, and in that process let's try to review few things which were already said by the UDF faculty, and remaining things we will try to talk from the NACO perspective or the present scenario in India in our program. So this slide is from the UDF presentation. So the faculty, he presented the 8 recruiting or recurrent themes on HIV and skin, and which are very practical and very relevant, and he also gave examples for each theme which we come across when we treat any PLHIV having dermatological manifestations. So first of all, skin is the largest organ in the body, we all know that, and next to blood and lymphatic, skin is the HIV is the most commonly affected organ. As blood and lymphatics, they are not organs, so if we talk in that sense, skin becomes the first or the most important organ which is affected in HIV. We have seen this in our previous sessions, how acute retroviral syndrome presents, and in that we have seen dermatological manifestations of that, and also we have seen the other some of the conditions in our session of the where we discussed WHO clinical staging. So, and that's how it helps in categorizing patients or staging a HIV positive. So, sometimes skin problem can be the first symptoms or the only sign of HIV infection. So that's what we saw in the acute retroviral syndrome slides, that when we see this, we can have, or that can be the first sign of HIV infection. So many of the skin related conditions are inflammatory and they are not infectious, and it is okay to, and also in fact it is encouraged to feel the lesions in most of the scenarios, so that we can make a better diagnosis. Skin is also an immune organ. Many conditions improve with ART. We have seen those conditions already, or some of them at least we have seen, where there is no treatment as such, but once you start ARTs, these clinical conditions improve. For example, we spoke about molluscum contagiosum. Some are brought on by ART, so especially those drug reactions and or cutaneous reactions by after giving antiretroviral drugs, so they can be adverse, they can be presented as adverse effect of the ART. Then multiple skin conditions also can exist in the same person, and especially these days when people treat all skin, most of the non-inflammatory skin conditions and other skin conditions with local steroids, which will change the morphology of the lesion, and it's very difficult to make a diagnosis, and sometimes mixed infections will also be there, and it's not very straightforward to make a particular diagnosis. So these are certain themes which were discussed in great detail in the session, which have been already uploaded. This slide is also from the UW faculty presentation. He tried to talk about four general categories in relation to HIV and skin. That is, and also acronym for that, he said INDI, which is easy to remember now. Infections, neoplasm. Infections includes all bacterial, fungal, parasitic, and other infections. Neoplasms, like most common malignancies, or HIV. AIDS defining malignancies or HIV associated malignancies, we'll see those in some details in the later part of the presentation, then drug related and also inflammatory. So broadly these four general categories can be seen. Now again, skin can be a portal for opportunistic infection, and also in many of the cases it may indicate the underlying systemic infection. For example, we saw, if you remember, the cases of cutaneous cryptococcus and also scrofuloderma, if you remember, skin TB, or can present as a skin manifestation of the systemic infection. Certain skin conditions like oral hairy leukoplakia or Kaposi sarcoma are very specific indicators of the immune system. The drug reactions are, again, it can happen with the other drugs, or it can happen commonly with many of the drugs. But if we compare that with general population, incidence of this adverse cutaneous drug eruptions is very much higher in those who are HIV positives, as against the general population, or almost it will be like 90 to 100 times high in the PLHIV or HIV positive population as compared to general population. Then skin problems are commonly seen in more than 90% of the HIV positive patients. So at one stage or the another, if you see many patients a day, then you carefully will be able to diagnose many of the patients with the skin problems. In scenarios of early and late immunodeficiencies, we can have different presentations. In early immunodeficiency, infectious disorders are commonly recurrent, self-healing, and clinically indistinguishable from the lesions in immunocompetent individual. As immunodeficiency progresses, lesions will be more persistent or progressive or non-healing and painful. For example, if you remember, we spoke about oral or anogenital herpes infection. So it depends on, again, the state of immunity. We can compare the same with this graph, which we had already seen earlier, but it can be reviewed along with, if you remember, the natural history of HIV infection we spoke about, and we spoke about this curve of the CD4. There will be initial drip, and there will be, after a long time of almost over 10 years, it will drop down. The CD4 will drop, and in the later stages of immunosuppression, you will see the skin manifestations or the skin diseases. It will be again serious or advanced diseases, and sometimes it is again much more widespread, and also it will include the malignancies or Kaposi sarcoma and diseases which cannot be usually treated with specific treatment, so that once we start ART, most of the diseases will respond. And some of the diseases, like for example scabies, which can happen at any CD4 level, but if the immunity is low, there can be again worse presentation of the scabies or widespread presentation of the scabies, like which is called as Norwegian scabies. We'll see a few cases of Norwegian scabies in the future slides. But the other diseases, as CD4 goes down, you will see the other diseases may appear with the decline in CD4. Now, this list of cutaneous disorders as indicators for HIV testing, it is again not an exhaustive list. It is, I would say, a smaller list, which is a like common indicator. You can say that if you see these disorders or cutaneous disorders in any patient, you can think of HIV and then you can order HIV in those patients. Exanthem of seroconversion, conversion, that is the initial skin manifestations in acute tetraviral syndrome. We'll talk about this. We already spoke about this, but we'll repeat. And oral candidiasis, oral hairy leukoplakia, herpes zoster, herpes, chronic herpetic ulcer, seborrheic dermatitis, PPE, molluscum contagiosum, and any other STIs. We'll see these one by one, how these are presented. Now, this is again indicator for HIV testing, primary HIV infection, which is also called as acute tetraviral syndrome. So these are the skin lesions which can be seen in the acute tetraviral syndrome. Usually 3 to 6 weeks after the exposure, it can be seen. These are small pink macules over the trunk and limbs. So they appear between 2 to 3 days after the onset of the glandular fever like illness, which lasts for 5 to 8 days. And the sites again can be upper thorax and face and forehead and scalp, and also there can be spots over the periphery or the extremities. Then they vary in numbers of macular and maculopapular lesion, with size ranging from few millimeter to 1 centimeter. Again, they can be general systemic manifestations of the infection, which we spoke about earlier, like myalgia, arthralgia, pharyngitis will be there in almost 50 to 70% of the clients. Then night sweats can persist, and less commonly oral manifestation and genital ulcers can be also seen in almost 15 to 20% of the clients. This is again very commonly seen, or I would say not so uncommon. Now, oral candidiasis, there can be various types of oral candidiasis or various presentations of oral candidiasis or candidiasis, I would say, starting from mild form of angular chelitis, where at the angle of the mouth you will see the lesions. The other types can be erythematous or atropic, also it is called as atropic type. Then pseudomembranous or hyperplastic type of candidiasis. So it can involve the oral cavity. It may also involve the soft palate, and if patient also might complain of difficulty or pain in deglutition, where we make the diagnosis of esophageal candidiasis. And when it is oral candidiasis, we categorize we stage that patient in clinical stage WHO clinical stage 3. And if it is involving soft palate and pharynx and esophagus, we say that it is WHO clinical stage 4. This is another indicator for HIV testing, that when you see this, you also can go for HIV testing. So on the lateral margins of the tongue, you can see the vertical lesions, or these are linear raised lesions over the side of the tongue. If you try to remove them, they are not easily removable. This is oral hairy leukoplakia, and it is caused by the Epstein-Barr virus. And when we see this, we classify or we stage the patient as WHO clinical stage 3. Then another common infection, I would say, that we see in our practice, that is herpes zoster. But if it is recurrent herpes zoster, it is obviously a very clear indication for HIV testing in those clients. So, and especially if you see these kinds of lesions, these are all like lesions over a dermatome, blisters you can see, or you can see multidermatomal involvement, and again very painful lesions, or very painful and vesicular lesions, very typical. And they will again, initial lesions might subside within 3-4 days, but again, chronic or recurrent herpes zoster will be a great problem for those patients. So, occurs in young age group, patients with history of zoster in last 5 years are diagnosed as stage 2. And if again, it can be treated with the tablet acyclovir, which can be given 800 milligrams 5 times a day for 2 weeks. Next in the list is chronic herpes simplex. Again, this is again not so good for the patient. This picture was from skin department of the JJ Hospital, Mumbai. And if you see this widespread involvement of genital area, usually herpes simplex virus 2 affects the genital, but both 1 and 2 can affect the genitals. And in such cases, you can see on the inspection how widespread the lesions are. So the visual inspection of the lesion and the clinical experience will help you in narrowing down the differential diagnosis. And pain is one of the leading symptoms these patients will present. These are multiple reddish chronic erosive herpetic lesions. So in these cases, we can also advise serology for herpes simplex virus, IgG, IgM, or PCR can also be done to confirm the diagnosis. But most of the cases, you don't require those blood tests to be done. You just start treatment with acyclovir, and they will respond. And this type of chronic herpes simplex, widespread, will be staged in clinical stage 4, because it is again widespread and chronic herpes simplex. Otherwise, it is usually in clinical stage 2. Another indicator for HIV testing is seborrheic dermatitis. In common terms, it is called as, we say dandruff, but it is again a type of dermatitis, or seborrheic dermatitis. It is enhanced, it is due to enhanced growth of yeast secondary to immunosuppression. Typically, you will see the greasy, scaly erythematous patches over the face and upper part of the trunk. It can be treated with selenium sulfide or zinc or ketoconazole or clotrimazole creams or shampoo. So these are the things which are helpful in treating this condition. Usually we stage in clinical stage 2. This is again very, you will see the lesions with central umbilications. Very typical of molluscum contagiosum. Again, there can be multiple differential diagnosis for molluscum contagiosum. Usually we see this condition in children, and face is most common area which is involved. It can be also there on the upper extremities or upper hand or upper limbs. And the causative agent for molluscum contagiosum is a DNA pox virus, and its treatment can be done with iodine or iodine cautery, but again, you can take also the biopsy to in which you can will be able to demonstrate HP bodies in for confirmation of this. But usually it is not required. The confirmation of this kind is not required usually. So, but again, in case of any doubt, it need to be done, because there are other conditions which mimic molluscum contagiosum. So in adults, if this kind of picture is seen, if you start ART, again ART is a treatment for this. It disappears after initiation of ART. So that is one of the most crucial aspect of treatment of this type of molluscum contagiosum. Sometime it will be there can be a giant molluscum contagiosum also, which will require some kind of treatment. Next in line is pruritic papular eruptions, or PPE, commonly called as. This I'm sure that every one of you who is doing clinical practice might have seen. It is extremely itchy disorder, and the most commonly, or it is, the cause is actually unknown, but it may represent an exaggerated response to the insect bites. It is again very itchy and generally we tend to prescribe antihistaminics or In severe cases, oral prednisolone can also be given, or topical corticosteroids can be also given. But more effective is the exposure to ultraviolet B phototherapy, and also in extreme cases, thalidomide can be tried. But usually, again, like I said, if we start with the ART in those patients, it will go away. This makes patients very uncomfortable, and if you give antihistaminics, there will be some kind of relief in many patients. So it can also, the other DDs can also be drug rash and chronic eczema. So based on the clinical situation and the clinical experience, the diagnosis can be made. In case of any STI, if you see any STI, you can go for HIV testing, or you must go for HIV testing in those scenarios. In this typical case, you can see the lesions over palms and also a lesion over the genital area. And what can it be? So we have, I think we have discussed this scenario in this case, I'm not very sure. So, but this is secondary syphilis. So where you see the cutaneous manifestations of secondary syphilis, and also you will see the genital lesions, again, very infectious stage. And treatment is benzathine penicillin again for secondary syphilis. The other way of putting the list is like, all these mucocutaneous manifestations can be subcategorized. The same it is in the infectious, inflammatory, cutaneous drug reactions and metabolic complications, neoplastic disorders, and immune restoration disease. Let's see them. Let's few things about them. Now here in this slide we can see the picture where it shows multiple erythematous papillonodular lesions surrounding the follicles in the genital area. It is a case of folliculitis. So pyodermas and soft tissue infections, caused by, again, very common staph aureus. So it can be presented as impetigo or ecthema, folliculitis, furuncles, carbuncles, cellulitis. And this is, again, a secondary infection of underlying dermatomes can be there. And the treatment is, again, all those antibiotics which are used to treat staph aureus can be used in these situations. And once immunity is good, again, there will be less and less such kind of infection. The next, if you see this, you will, or many of us might think that this is just a skin condition, but this is the lesion in axilla, and it has involved the axillary lymph nodes and also the overlying skin. You can see unless we touch it and unless we examine this, we will not be able to identify the lymph node which is underlying. So this is not just a skin condition, but actually the problem is in the underlying lymph node. So this lymph node is having infection, and it has, again, the eroded or liquefaction has happened in that chronic infection. It has come out and perforated the skin to form a sinus, and that is why you are seeing some kind of discharge as well. You can see the necrotizing base and indolent margins. So this is scrofuloderma, that is skin tuberculosis. So unless we feel the lymph node and we see the lesion, we might think that this is just a superficial skin abnormality, but usually it will be there will be a lymph node which is affected. In this case, it is an axillary lymph node, and there will be a sinus formation. That means whenever liquefaction happens, it comes towards the skin, it will erode the skin, and it will come out. So the opening can be seen over the skin surface. Again, scrofuloderma, you treat them as a any other case of typical tuberculosis. Now this is very interesting. A 28 years old male who was recently started on ART, on his CD4 count below 250, and 1 month after the initiation of ART, he came back to the ART center with a well-defined erythematous lesion over the knee, as shown in this figure. If I say a few more things about this, you'll be able to make the differentials or the diagnosis. These are again, there are no pain sensations over the area, or pain sensations are absent. So this is a picture which is showing a typical type 1 reaction in case of borderline tuberculoid leprosy as an immune reconstitution inflammatory syndrome. So probably AFV has entered through the site of injury and gradually involving the cutaneous nerve. So infrapatellar cutaneous nerve is involved in this case and ultimately producing the cutaneous skin lesions of borderline tuberculoid leprosy. So in cases of such cases, because these days we usually forget about leprosies and we always think about the other, like tinea corporis or drug rash and other things, but leprosy is still one condition which we can't afford to forget, at least in HIV scenario. So whenever the CD4 levels are low, and for example in this case that is below 250, started on ERT, developing such lesions, and we need to think of leprosy. And it is again as a multibacillary disease, it is treated with the typical course of anti-leprosy treatment, so which might have rifampicin. So if rifampicin is there, obviously we'll have to see if the person is on nevirapine or PI based regimen that need to be changed. The best possible regimen will be if evidence based regimen in this case. So this is another skin lesion, and in this we can see multiple papulovesicular lesions seen over the lower lip, and this is usual site for HSV infection. And usually the oral the HSV, that is herpes simplex virus type 1, is involved, but both herpes simplex virus 1 and 2 can be the reason for such kind of skin lesions. The treatment for that is we can give acyclovir 200 milligrams five times a day for 7 to 10 days. In case of repeated infection or in recurrent severe infection, you can also give 400 milligrams three times a day for 2 to 3 weeks, or sometimes the treatment is extended for longer duration of time in case of again disseminated lesions. Sometimes it goes on and on. Anyway, so this is the next case where you can see the warts. These are multiple warty lesion in on both the arms. The other differentials for this can be giant molluscum, cutaneous TB, fungal infections, or histoplasmosis. Such are the so this may mimic other skin conditions as well. So, but general causative agent for warts is DNA virus, that is human papilloma virus or HPV. The treatment can be electrocautery or cryotherapy for this kind of treatment, but again it tend to recur again and again, or there is a tendency of repeated recurrence. So increasingly poor response to treatment as the degree of immune suppression increases. So that is why if we start ART, again the chances of recurrence will be lesser than usual. This is another lesion which I'm sure every one of you might have seen this kind of lesion in your cases or in your practice. This is a large patch. If you see on the left hand side, that is case 1, large patch can be seen with advancing borders and central cleaning. It is tinea, both are tinea corporis. Now on the right, if you can see in axilla, this patch with advancing borders and central clearing, it will be again itchy. If you do the skin scraping and see in the microscope, you can see the fungal hyphae, but usually it is not required. So topical antifungals like clotrimazole is helpful in most of the cases, but if the lesions are extensive or resistant, you might have to use systemic antifungals in those scenarios. Then next is, again, this is what we had seen in the earlier session of WHO clinical staging also. This is onychomycosis, that is fungal infection of the nails, and usually we categorize this in WHO clinical stage 2. Now you can treat this with a tablet fluconazole that is given in 150 milligram once a week. Another lesion which again mimics the other lesions which we saw before, that is a skin lesion or papular lesions with central umbilication, which may have the other other differentials also might have to be considered in this scenario. But if this patient, if I say that the patient is an is having fever, headache, neck stiffness for 3-4 weeks or 1 month, and then subsequently develop this kind of skin lesion, which are umbilicated papular and nodular lesions, then you might think of cutaneous cryptococcus is first before meristem contagiosum. But in absence of those that particular history, you might think of the common things first, that is, you can think of meristem contagiosum. If you are in northeast and there are again some infections like Penicillium marnefi, which again is carried in bamboo rats, so in that particular lesion you might also think of Penicillium marnefi. But this can also be seen as a wart, or acneiform lesions can also be seen like this. So there can be multiple DDs depending on which area you are in, and also your clinical experience. You can make the you can have the list of your own differentials for this particular lesion. Now this is another lesion which is from RIMS Imphal Manipur. This picture or this case is from RIMS Imphal Manipur. This is a lesion with central umbilication or central umbilicated papules, you can see, and this is a case of penicilliosis, or which is because of Penicillium marnefi infection. It is it was treated with itraconazole, and you can see the crested lesions during the treatment and after the treatment. Scabies, all of you might have seen scabies. It is very itchy condition, you can see, and this is a presentation of scabies, which is again very widespread. These pictures are from Chennai and also from BGMC, that is a COE in Ahmedabad. This is a PLHIV which is on ART with severe itching, where you can see this multiple scaling and crusting over the entire body and hands and feet, hyperpigmented papules and nodules with itching. Both these are cases of Norwegian scabies. So it is called as Norwegian scabies, and it happens in advanced clinical immunodeficiency situations. The topical permethrin or benzyl benzoate can be used with ketolytics, or you can also use oral ivermectin. Usually it is used in the dose of 200 microgram per kg weekly. Both the options are good, but other than treating the patients, the whole lot of other things also will have to be done, that all contacts will have to be treated, then beds need to be washed properly. So all those precautions need to be taken, and when you ask patients to apply benzoyl benzoate, it need to be applied below the neck. So those precautions, and in the night and in the morning should take a bath. All those precautions are more important than just giving the or just giving a prescription to these clients. As I said, inflammatory disorders are again very common in HIV positives. So first is pruritic papular eruptions. We have already seen few a case of this before. So these are eruptions which cause a significant morbidity in the client. Basically, these are like very itchy lesions. So empirical therapies, they provide only minimal relief, like I mentioned about the antihistaminics and all. A typical primary lesion is a firm discrete erythematous papule, and mostly extremities are involved, and again not a good condition to have. If you have seen cases of this, you will realize that patients will be very uncomfortable, and you can also see the hyperpigmentation of the skin. Now other conditions which like eosinophilic folliculitis, which as name suggests, it is lot of eosinophils will be there in the hair follicles of the skin. Clinically, which is characterized by multiple follicular and non-follicular itchy papules or urticarial papules. So in that scenarios, you can treat with the phototherapy or topical tacrolimus or other medicines can be used for this particular condition. Again, there is, will be a problem resistant to treatment, that is topical steroids, oral isotretinoin and phototherapy can also be used. And rarely high dose of itraconazole can be used in such situations. But again, as you start ART, these conditions will slowly disappear. The next is on the upper, in the upper picture, you can see psoriasis, and in the bottom, the lower picture, that is from JJ Hospital, Mumbai again, it is a xerosis. So in psoriasis, again, the difference here, we can see the red plaques with thick silvery scales over the elbows and knees and lumbosacral areas. It may also include the nail pitting, dystrophy, arthritis, and possible pruritus. Treatment, again, improvement of the immune system is the main stay of the treatment. It is same as HIV negatives. Phototherapy can be used for therapy of this psoriasis in these patients, especially those who are HIV positives. But in HIV negatives, we use methotrexate and immunosuppressive drugs also, which cannot be used, unfortunately, in HIV positives. So that is one main difference, but otherwise there is no major difference between the treatment of HIV positives and negatives. Then Reiter syndrome and xerosis, which is again very common condition. You can see it is due to diminished sweating and sebaceous gland secretion possibility due to malabsorption of essential fatty acids. So you can see this kind of lesion in there, and treatment will again include the creams or soaps or nutritional supplements can be given so that that malabsorption of essential fatty acids can be dealt with and this condition may not appear. There are some metabolic complications also. We have seen these pictures before. Starting from drug reactions, which can be mild or severe, it can be only pruritus. There was one very good case which was shown by the UDA faculty in the lecture. So you will appreciate that case, and also, and why I'm saying that is because that was immediately after giving ART. After some time, the person developed all those lesions like dryness of skin and all, and some scaly lesions were there, and they hospitalized that client, and after that, these lesions of which we all know about, like Steven Johnson's syndrome. So those appeared within the hospital, and they could see all those stages. So the trick here is, or the one thing which where we need to focus on is, like, we need to identify these types of skin reactions early so that we can hospitalize the client, and then we can monitor those clients so that we can treat it better. So it can be a spectrum of presentation ranging from general just pruritus or urticaria or fixed drug interruptions, and also to Steven Johnson syndrome. And the last, the most severe form can be toxic epidermal necrolysis. So it can also, it can happen because of nevirapine or many other drugs may lead to this type of condition. So all skin reactions are considered to be drug eruptions when they occur within 30 days, especially after the onset of treatment with especially drugs like sulfa and all. You might have seen situations like this. So, if depending on the severity, we take the action, and if it is generalized or has any mucosal involvement or systemic involvement like jaundice, all drugs will have to be stopped. That is the reason whenever you start any patient on ART, you talk about these conditions and you tell them that if there is any mucosal involvement like reddening of eyes or oral ulcers or even genital ulcers or even anal ulcers, so that also can be a sign of drug reactions. So immediately after starting ART, especially within first few days and up till 1 month, we need to review the clients so that if any of such things are observed, we can hospitalize those clients and we can monitor it in a better way. So it is important to grade the toxicity whenever it is seen So four grades we had already discussed in the previous presentations. If the rash is mild, we can wait and watch. But in this situation, and in this situation, patient need to be reviewed. And again, if there is any kind of worsening or mucosal involvement, then drugs need to be discontinued. So, nevirapine, which we start usually with a single dose or one dose of a day, should not be exhaled to twice a day until the rash settles. And many of the settles, many of the patients, the rash will be minimal, or it will not. It will be again low grade. And almost up to the range of 30% patients will have a rash with nevirapine for a few days. It is self-limiting. For some time it will be there and then it will disappear. But if it involves mucosal areas, then that should ring the alarm and we need to take the action at that point of time. You cannot just continue nevirapine. But if it is not involving mucosal areas and just skin and some kind of local rash, then it need to be managed. So usually it is said that if it is less than 10% of the body surface area, then it is said to be a Stevens-Johnson syndrome. And if it is more than 30% of the body surface area, it is said to be a toxic epidermal necrolysis. And it is, like I said, it is a spectrum of conditions. So in between, it is an overlap of SJS and TEN. This is again a condition where surprisingly it is less commonly seen in India. Some of the cases have been reported in India, and especially this from Manipur. And in fact, I think Manipur is one of very few states which has reported cases of Kaposi's sarcoma in our country. The direct relation of this cancer is with HHV-8, that is human herpes virus 8. So in clinical presentation you will see the purple flat macules, or blue or dark purple flat macules. In this case it is eye which is involved, but there are other areas also which might get involved in this kind of condition. So the lesions will become lobulated as the disease progresses. So the typical manifestation is purplish lesion, but based on the skin color, the color of the lesion might change. It can happen anywhere. It can happen in the oral cavity, or it can also follow an aggressive course with widespread cutaneous and systemic dissemination or systemic lesions. But the common sites have been trunk, leg, face, and oral cavity. The treatment for this is, again, ART is a good treatment. If you start ART, the disease will be self-limiting. Topical treatment can be given if the CD4 counts are higher. But systemic treatment with liposomal doxorubicin can be given, which is, again, the availability is an issue in countries like India. I don't know if it is available or not. So, but again, this is one condition which we need to remember. I have seen just one case in last 10 years of my career in HIV. I have not seen any cases of Kaposi's sarcoma as such. Again, that was an accidental. I'm not doing a clinical practice, but again, during my visits, I just saw one case of Kaposi's sarcoma as of now. And my gut feeling is that there can be some cases which might get presented to us, and we may miss these cases because of multiple reasons. Sometimes if it is not very obvious, it will be like the we may miss the examination of it, and also sometimes because of poor lab support also we are not able to make the diagnosis or confirm the diagnosis. But this is again one condition which we need to remember. We'll talk about more about Kaposi's in our next part of the presentation as well, when we discuss the malignancies. So these are the other presentation of Kaposi's. If you can see here, there is a lesion in the mouth and lesion in the sole. And this is from JJ Hospital, Mumbai. So Manipur and Maharashtra. Here again, appearance-wise, if you see and if you compare, It looks very similar, molluscum contagiosum, cutaneous cryptococcus, penicilliosis, and like I said, and all of them will have a central umbilication. Like I said, depending on the other correlated conditions, we can prioritize or we can do our list of differentials. But again, region wise, if you see, some of the regions will have prevalence of some of the diseases more in that region, so we can think in those lines. So again, mucocutaneous lesions, the evidence can be based on skin smears and nail clipping, serology, staining for causative organisms, and biopsy. Many of the cases we don't require we need not confirm it, and if facility is there, obviously means you should confirm any diagnosis. For example, in the top picture you can see the several differentials you can think of when you see picture like this, like molluscum cryptococcus or cutaneous cryptococcus, or even histoplasmosis, penicilliosis, and you can see in the bottom picture the this is a lesion identified only on the HPE as a histoplasmosis. So just looking at the morphology of the lesion, you can make the diagnosis like, okay, it is showing central umbilication and it is typical of common lesions. But in this case, for example, when biopsy was done and when it was seen in the microscope, it was found to have histoplasmosis. This is again, I think, the case from the JJ Hospital, Mumbai. So unless we take help of the lab, and lab also should be good in the sense to experienced in making the diagnosis like this, and for which clinicians also need to help the lab people by giving detailed history to the lab personnel, so that it will help them in making appropriate diagnosis. So the treatment for this will be a standard treatment based on the etiology, and correct diagnosis is the key. Appropriate dose and duration need to be given to prevent the relapses, and rule out the drug resistance if it is there, and if your treatment is not working. And the last bullet is the most important, I think, especially in these type of inflammatory and other type of lesion also, infective lesion also, where the initiation of ART is the most important thing. So just as a bullet or the key point, more than 90% of HIV infected patients develop skin and mucous membrane lesions, but no skin condition is specific to HIV, and identification of certain skin conditions can predict the presence of HIV infection, and then so that we can, it will be helpful for us to make the to subject the person for the investigations. And persisting, recurrent, and chronic severe resistant and atypical lesions are common in PLHIV, especially those who are not on treatment. So as a clinician or the medical officer working at the ART center, there are few recommendations. Again, whenever you see new patients, examine the patients thoroughly, especially when the CD4 counts are low, and carrying again, torch is very important, which is functional torch or working torch, so that you can see the oral cavity and other areas. Examining the genitals is very crucial in all patients, especially when they are registered as new clients. And those who are dermatologists may also carry the magnifying lenses, so that they can see the lesions and they can document those lesions. But it is again not a bad idea to have, even if you are not a dermatologist. Especially in the ART center, you can just keep it, and whenever you see, you can see and try to diagnose. So again, experience counts a lot. Dermatologists are used to seeing these cases in day in and day out, so they make the diagnosis with their experience. So, but HIV has given us an opportunity to bring in all these conditions together. And again, we have an opportunity now to learn those things. So by looking at these lesions, because no picture is typical in HIV positive especially. So your experience will only tell you what that condition might be. So in case of any confusion or opinion, you should not hesitate to take help of any dermatologist of the institution. Okay, I missed. If there are questions, I'll just review, or else we'll go to the next part. Are dog rashes common with TLE? Rare. Efavirenz, see, NNRTS can have dog rashes. Lamivudine can also have skin rashes, but as Dr. Jyoti is mentioning, it is not very common, as not as common as other. Actually, if you look at all the clients, those who develop dog rashes, the percentage, if you see in the as a denominator, as all clients, you will see it very rarely. But you cannot, we cannot say that they do not produce. They can produce, or they can be drug rashes because of these drugs. Yeah, I agree. It is not very common, but it can happen. But we had some patients with high CD4 develop rashes. Yes, it can happen. It is true in that some patients can develop, but rare, but still develop rash. Okay. Integrate the rash to the appropriate. Okay. Yeah. I agree with all these comments. The rash grading is very, very crucial to take the action. So please refer to those previous slides where we talked about grading of the rashes, or you can also refer to detailed guidelines on that in OI guideline document, previous OI guideline. There was no new OI treatment guideline document in which the details of these grading of the rashes and everything has been given. And also, if you have that pocket book or blue book, in that also grading has been given. Okay, so I know that this is not sufficient for this particular topic, but for considering our limitations, I'll urge you to see that session also from the UW faculty. It is very good session, and you can take help of this. But experience is the key, and try to diagnose things and document those things so that. And don't hesitate to make a mistake in making your diagnosis, but make the diagnosis and take help of dermatologists, and so that slowly our clinical skills improve in making these diagnoses. Okay, so we'll go to quickly the next part, that is HIV related malignancies. Now, when we talk about malignancies, there are two terms which are commonly used in HIV, that is AIDS defining malignancies, that is, if this malignancy is seen in a patient, you might think of having ICTC done or HIV testing done in those clients. So those are called as AIDS defining malignancies. And others are non-AIDS defining malignancies, which are also called as AIDS HIV associated malignancies. Those are present in PLHIVs, not always because of HIV positive status. So this is one of the examples or one of the study which shows the mortality of HIV due to cancer. That is in 2000, this is a, again, very old study, but it is still holds true that 15% of the deaths are due to HIV AIDS malignancies and 13% due to non-AIDS related malignancies in this French study. So it is estimated that 3-4% of PLHIV in India will have a cancer during their course. Compared to 34% in the developed countries. Again, in India, the one major problem has always been that the diagnostic facilities of confirmation of malignancies in peripheries are not much. So we tend to miss many cases of malignancies. So these are not documented as such. But estimations are like 3-4% of PLHIV in India will have cancer in their course. Now, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, that is NHL, the large B-cell lymphomas or non-Hodgkin's lymphoma appear to be the most common type of cancer reported in the Indian PLHIV. In one of the studies in Mumbai, it constituted to 38% of. Excuse me. One second. Yeah, okay. I'm sorry. So NHL constituted 38% of the cancer seen in male PLHIV, while 16% in the female PLHIV because of predominance of cervical cancers in female. We spoke about this fact that NHL, that is non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, is again linked to because the cervical cancers, it is related to human papilloma virus, and it is very common in females, and that is why you can see 16% of the female PLHIV will have in this study were shown as NHL, but in males, if you see, it is 38% of the cancers. In HIV positive men, increased proportional increase rate. So this is important to note that this proportional incidence rate of these cancers is very high. That is 17-fold higher as compared to HIV negative incidence of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and 4-fold increase of Hodgkin's lymphoma has been seen. In women, NHL or non-Hodgkin's lymphoma has been increased by 10-fold. So it is not just the incidence is high, it is as compared to the HIV negative population, if you see, the proportionate increase in the conditions, it is higher in HIV positives. So non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is most common cancer among HIV infected children, and again proportional incidence rate was significantly increased. That means HIV, in presence of HIV, it is almost 17% higher chance of getting NHL as compared to HIV negative. Cancer may be presenting AIDS defining illness in HIV infected children. Malignancies in children are present at advanced stage and have poor prognosis. Again, significant immune suppression was not commonly seen and associated with high cancers. Among children must be kept in mind, and pediatricians, by pediatrician especially in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. This is again a Mumbai study. So, okay, so these are the AIDS defining malignancies. As I said, Kaposi's sarcoma is said to be AIDS defining malignancies, and we mentioned the virus for Kaposi's sarcoma. What was it? Can someone remind me what was the virus we mentioned which is linked to Kaposi's sarcoma? Any answers? Yes, HHV-8, that is human herpes virus 8, we said. The non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, other lymphomas like primary CNS lymphoma. Again, primary CNS lymphoma is very rare and it is not very common. So primary CNS lymphoma, again Burkitt's lymphoma, like the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and then cervical cancer, very lately cervical cancer, that is invasive cervical cancer, not just carcinoma in situ or non-invasive, or invasive cervical cancer has been said to be AIDS defining malignancies. Inclusion of this invasive cervical cancer as AIDS defining malignancy was done very late, and earlier when it all started, it was not there in the list. So these three cancers, that is Kaposi's sarcoma, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and cervical cancer or invasive cervical cancer, are called as AIDS-defining malignancies, and also the primary CNS lymphoma. These are some of the examples of which viruses are attached. In many of the cases, you will not be able to find the correlation between the cancer and the virus, or these are not, the causative organism is not the virus, and the causes might be unknown. But some of the cancers can be linked to the viruses, especially, for example, this B-cell lymphoma or Burkitt's lymphoma is linked to the Epstein-Barr virus. It's almost a higher percentage of the people will have this, and the cause can be Epstein-Barr virus. Then hepatitis B and C virus, if not treated, they might also cause hepatocellular carcinoma. Then HPV, cervical cancer, and anal cancer, that is again the common most common cancer in females as a cervical cancer. Human T-cell leukemia virus, HTLV, that is may cause T-cell leukemia, and other like HHV-8, we saw Kaposi's sarcoma or primary effusion lymphoma, which is again rare, and other categories are there. So risk of AIDS defining cancers in HIV patients versus general population, if you see this risk, like 4,44,000 almost patients, meta-analysis in resource-rich region consistently found standard incidence ratio cancers up to 3,600 times of the general population. So Kaposi's sarcoma, it is again, in as compared to general population, 3,640 times higher in HIV positives. And cervical cancer 5.3, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is 22.6 as compared to the general population. Now we'll see few cases. This is the first case, that is 44 years old PLHIV with baseline CD4 of 32. And the shows asymptomatic erythematous papular lesions over the face. You can see these papular lesions. Papules is raised margin above the skin level. Then multiple bilateral free mobile non-tender 3 cm lymph node with normal skin over the cervical area. Obviously it is not very clearly seen here, but for that we need to do palpation. Bilateral freely mobile non-tender and 3 cm lymph node size, which is the skin, if you see, is the normal over the cervical area. Sputum AFV is negative in this case, so this is and also FNAC was done, which is also negative. CT abdomen was done, and it was found to be having multiple nodes in the left paraortic and aorta cavil region. Small rounded hypodense lesions in the anterior aspect of the upper lobe, upper pole of the right and mid pole of the left kidney. So query lymphadenomatous deposits in the minimal pleural effusion, large irregular infiltrates of poorly differentiated lymphoid cells of medium size, cutaneous lymphoma, and bone marrow study was seen where it was diagnosed to be having consistent with stage 4 non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. But the differentials are important in such cases. You can see the chest x-ray also, where you can see the mediastinal enlargement because of the mediastinal lymph node involvement. But we need to see the all spectrum of possibilities in such cases, wherever you see the mediastinal, abdominal or cervical lesions like this, or in for that matter, generalized lymphadenopathy. The non-infectious etiologies can also cause lymphadenopathy, for example, cases like rheumatologic or autoimmune cases like rheumatoid arthritis, sarcoidosis, and of course lymphomas and leukemias are the one. We need to also consider the infective etiologies in such cases, for fever or lymphadenopathy. Note that the patient was having fever for 3 months due to unrelated etiology. And mycobacterium tuberculosis, again extremely common in our country at least, and those who are very much immunocompromised, in those patients we need to see. But as it is a generalized lymphadenopathy or adenopathy, and also along with that there is a fever and weight loss, we need to think of TB also in such patients. MAC, that is Mycobacterium avium complex, is one of the possibilities again, but it is less common in India as compared to the general TB. Then fungal infections like histoplasma, cryptococcus and penicillium can also be considered. Secondary syphilis also can have lymphadenopathy. Then drug reaction or serum sickness and recent immunizations, but if there is history, that can be considered of. Then other disseminated infections like visceral leishmaniasis rickettsia in children, and such diseases, especially depending on which population you are dealing with, those need to be considered. For NHL, again, it is one of the three AIDS defining malignancies. It is particularly important, especially in this area when we are giving combination ART to our clients. We already saw that in the first slide that almost 30% significantly increased risk of NHL in our patients, especially when the immunity is very low. And 15% reduction in risk of NHL for each year spent receiving ART. So ART is one thing which is very crucial for prevention of NHL and also for the treatment of NHL, because again, Epstein-Barr virus infection and immunosuppression are the only known risk factors for development of such malignancies. Here is another case, 39 years HIV positive male was on ART, that is SLN, August 2004 with baseline CD4 of 56. In 2006, there were spontaneous fractures of left tibia and radius, and CD4 was good. So you can see here there is a pathological fracture history where there is involvement of bones, and in the picture it can be clearly seen here. You can see the these areas of darkness here in the bone, which are again the areas where which are involved by the spread of the cancers to bone, and because of that reason multiple fractures can be seen. So biopsy from these osteolytic regions from tibia was done, then high grade NHL was found, immunoprofile of neoplastic cells. So you can see the tumor markers also in the blood, positive for CD4, CD79A and others. Then Epstein-Barr virus was negative in this case. Another case, you can see again lymphoma presenting as subcutaneous nodules. There are multiple subcutaneous nodules, and when the biopsy was done, again FNAC may not work, FNAC may not show the complete picture. So incisional biopsy is recommended for such cases so that definite diagnosis can be made. Kaposi sarcoma, I mentioned few things about this cancer before. It was described first in 1872. Again, not very common in India, but again reported from some of the regions. It is a multi-system and multicentric disease attributed to HHV-8 virus. Then case primarily affects skin and mucosa, muco or musculoskeletal case lesions are rare, but they may also occur mostly combined with aggressive cutaneous mucosal case lesions. It is rare in India. Manipur reports quite sizable number of these cases, and we also saw one case from JJ Hospital, Mumbai. You can see the lesion here, again a purplish lesion. This is not very common site or very typical site, I would say. It is again can happen in the mouth, or it's not very uncommon to happen in the mouth also. So you can see all this soft follicles as well. So this is before treatment and after treatment. And this was the case we already saw, which is from Mumbai. Let's skip these slides. Non-AIDS defining cancers. Again, treatment, as I said, is ART is a good treatment even for the treatment of KS. And we spoke about liposomal doxorubicin also for treatment of KS. Non-AIDS defining malignancies, Hodgkin's disease, anal cancer, multiple myelomas, leukemias, lung cancer, and especially people who smoke, head and neck tumors, GI malignancies, and others. So there is a list is long for non-AIDS defining malignancies, and these are called as AIDS associated malignancies. So some of the mechanisms for lung cancer can be, like I said, history of smoking will be important to note. Then potential immunologic mechanism can be chronic pulmonary inflammation, repeated infections, Hodgkin's lymphoma, immunosuppression can be a cause. Then anal cancers, immunosuppression in relation to the early stage neoplasia, duration of immune suppression will again play a big role. Liver cancer, co-infections is one thing, and also immune suppression and duration of immune suppression plays a role. Then non-melanoma skin cancer, immunosuppression is one of the important factor. Another case, 36 years male, Weaver bioco patient, HIV positive since 2004, not on ART, approached physician with complaints of breathlessness, cough and expectoration in the first week of May 2006. Apparently free, symptom free till 2 months back, no other significant past illness. Known smoker and alcoholic, diagnosed as of having pleural effusion, straw colored pleural effusion as aspirated, and as most of us will do, we treat that with anti-TB drugs as a, considering that it is a pleural effusion. So with the presumptive diagnosis of TB, but it did not help. And this, these were the serial CD4 counts, that is in 2005, 2006, and after after the next month it was 335. Just see, only in 1 month it has dropped a lot. So complete hematology, renal function and blood sugar were normal. Liver functions were also done in this case. It was raised serum alkaline phosphatase, on two occasions pleural fluid showed normal study except raised proteins. And if you see the x-rays, this is the x-ray, and then in intercostal tube was put in because of repeated pleural effusions. Again, this is like reaccumulation of the pleural fluid after the tapping, and that is where the tube was put in this case. So, and for that you require again a larger fluid to be sent for the examination, and also pleural fluid cytology showed malignant cells, and the probable diagnosis which was made was adenocarcinoma in this case. 36 years, another case, 36 years male on ART, that is ZLE, since 2006, treated with sputum positive pulmonary TB earlier twice, that is category 1, category 2 was given, and then patient continued to be sputum smear positive after, for AFV, evaluated for MDR, and testicular swelling was found in 2008 in this patient. The patient is already on ART, treated multiple times for TB, and now there is a testicular swelling. On examination, there is a oral candidiasis, pan-digital clubbing, which again indicates the chronic illness or chronicity of the illness, uniform and hard swelling of the scrotum, in the scrotum, which cannot be separated from the testis, 10 by 10 centimeter in size. Skin over the swelling is stretched, and cord sensations are absent. Left side testes and cord structures are normal, and other systems are normal. And when this is again a chest x-ray of the client, where you can see some of the secondaries here in the lungs as well. This is a CT scan showing the lesions. USG findings, right testes, it measures again more than 12 by 10 centimeters in size, with mixed echogenic testes with areas of focal calcification. Tunica vaginal is sacs, there is some minimal fluid in it, and then right testis is not separately visualized. Epididymis is not again seen, and the left testis is a normal size, where the other things are normal. So this is a case of seminoma, increased significantly with HIV-AIDS. The risk is with HIV-AIDS is high. The point being, mentioning these cases is, again, we need to remember HIV-associated malignancies even if your patients are on ART. Most of our friends in ART center, we are so into the ART and OIs, we usually tend to forget the non-infectious causes of the morbidities in the clients, especially those who are on ART for longer duration of time, and with the other co-infections or co-factors which may become as a risk factor for development of malignancies. So smoking and other things are common in them. We need to carefully see, and as time goes by, when, see, here is a point that we need to remember that with time, more OIs we will be seeing less and less OIs, and we'll be seeing more and more patients who are on ART for longer duration of time, and where we will be coming across many cases of toxicities to the ART or adverse reactions to the ART, but along with that, the lifestyle related diseases or also the malignancies and all, we might see them even if our patients are on ART. So the earlier diagnosis is the key, or the actively looking for these lesions is very important, so that we can guide them in a better way for earlier diagnosis. For example, like for cervical cancers, so doing Pap smear is very important in females and males, especially those who are MSM. I know that many of the centers will not have facilities. Sample collection is okay, but you don't have pathologists to see. So, but nevertheless, we need to make efforts that wherever it is possible, at least in medical colleges, don't forget or don't miss those opportunities to diagnose the patients. And this is very important that we need to talk to the pathologist and microbiologist and should share the clinical scenarios. Just don't send the patient with the lab form, which doesn't say anything about the history and other things, other details. So whenever you see any investigation, in the lab form itself, you try to mention what are you thinking about or what are your differentials based on the clinical examination of the client. So this, again, earlier diagnosis of the malignancies might save many lives in many of the patients. So anal cancers can be because of HPV, lung cancers can be because of smoking, and so these are the actions which we need to advise to the client. And other and many of the cases you can see here, heart, that is highly active antiretroviral therapy is written, which is one of the best treatment for these kinds of malignancies if the patients are not on ART treatment. So increasing survival of HIV infected patients may predispose to an epidemic of malignancies among long-term survivors. So we need to remember that. Now the things are changing so quickly. Most of our patients are going on ART in very early stage of the disease, so you'll not be seeing like those typical infections we were seeing some time back. So slowly they will come down, but it doesn't mean that HIV is going away. We still have patients, and in long run we need to see that how can we develop our capacities to at least diagnose these malignancies or keep our eye on while we do the examinations and detailed examinations of these clients. And whenever we need help, please don't hesitate in taking help of the other specialists in the hospital or even away in the other facilities. So Kaposi's sarcoma, cervical cancers, and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma are called as AIDS-defining malignancies. Non-AIDS-defining malignancies like anal cancers, lung cancers, prostate, and also for that matter breast cancers and all, hepatocellular cancers can be seen as non-AIDS-defining malignancies. ART use may be associated with decline in some but not all malignancies. We need to keep that in mind that patients on long-term ART may also have these cancers. Effective screening and prevention of measures have yet to be defined for non-AIDS defining malignancies in PLHIV. So the comprehensive approach and the linkages with the specialties and active looking or active screening of the OIs, the malignancies in case of risk, if you see any risk factors, that those are the things which are very important, and we need to do whatever we can in our limited capacity if you don't have any other support. But those institutions which are very well in managing these, at least we should be able to define or establish the linkage mechanism or referral mechanisms for these patients. Okay, I think this is the first time we are finishing before time, like before 12:30. So that's it from my side. If there are any comments, I'll just see in the chat box if there are any comments. Okay, thank you for responding to all those queries in the comments. That was very helpful. So, okay, so if there are any no more questions, just a routine reminder as always. So this is, we are halfway through. We have finished 5 clinical contact sessions. Please see to it that you, there can be some misunderstanding. I'm feeling from the WhatsApp messages and all, and that some people might really, very religiously go through all these clinical contact sessions, but may not be attending those 2 lectures of the UDA faculty and may not be solving quizzes, which is actually, if that is happening, it will be a disaster. So you need to see the lectures and you need to solve quizzes and homework assignments.
environment. Based on that, our which is there on the UW University of Washington canvas, and based on that, our certificate completion is decided. This participation, these clinical contact sessions, as I said, it's mandatory and is another requirement for completion of the course. Now it is a time, I think we will reassess that all of all those applicants, how many are attending these sessions and how many are able to access quizzes and all, and based on that we will continue, or we'll see that those who have never participated in any of the clinical contact session and never solved any quizzes will again take them out of the course. So thank you so much for your participation. We'll see you next week with the next